Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shabbat, Shabbat Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat 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 Shalom. Oh, okay. All right. We're going to do that again. Sing it to one another, and let's have a real hey at the end, okay? Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat. Sing it to one another.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat 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 Shalom. Hey.
Amen. Well, let's have one more opening song this morning. It's this newer song that we're teaching you. Sing Hallelujah.
Every voice in this place, sing Hallelujah. Praise our God, seek His face. Hallelujah. Every tribe, every tongue, sing hallelujah. Everything, everyone, sing hallelujah. For Yahweh our God is a righteous King, sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah today. Amen.
Amen. Amen. There it is. It's there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. You look that stunned look like, okay, fine. Thank you very much. I'll take cookies. Okay. Thank you so much for coming this morning. Isn't it marvelous to be together once again? You guys look so handsome and pretty. Can you hear me all right? It has a green light right there. It's on. Are we on? I have a green light, which means go. Can you hear me all right now?
Yes.
Going once, going, there it is. We'll start again. Welcome to Cornerstone. I'm so glad you guys could come. Isn't it exciting to be in cool, fresh Oregon, huh? Yeah. I'm looking at us, and I just chuckled to myself. If we were to take this assembly and we were to beam you in Hawaii, we could light the island Hawaii up with all of our whiteness. We are not used to this kind of sunshine and heat. I mean, how many of you are already applying suntan lotion? We only have one. Okay. Anyway, thank you so much for coming. I think we're going to have a grand time. The Heavenly Father is wonderful. We made it through another week. We only had to work 4 days, right? Isn't that good? How many of you would like to have that go on and on and on? You get paid for five, but you only work four. Uh-huh. Some of you don't really care, do you? Okay, that's fine. That's exciting. Anyway, there's been a lot going on in the world, and yet we can come in here because the Heavenly Father has given us the freedoms to come together and worship. Fellowship with one another. Can you imagine? We take fellowship so for granted. We need to just be excited. You know, you read in the scriptures when in the time of the sages, they made a point to encourage people that before they came to the synagogue, they were to run to the synagogue because of the excitement. Now, I have to admit, I haven't seen anybody running to get in here. Well, maybe because it was cooler, they're running again to get cooler. But normally, we don't find anybody, they can't wait to get to service, so they run into it. And then when they left back in those days, they would walk backwards slowly as if, I really don't want to leave. I've never witnessed that here. Have you ever watched anybody walk slowly backwards out of this assembly? We would probably call for help if we did. It's amazing, though, that we can do these kind of things. Yes.
Last Sabbath, there was a gentleman who left the facility walking backwards.
Wow. He forgot which direction south was. Anyway, I'm so glad you could come. This is an exciting to be here. Thank you so much for putting us on your schedule, and you made it this morning. Before I have the gentleman come up, and we are going to honor and pray for the children, Rick has some exciting news for us. Buckle your seatbelts. This, what he's going to share with you, a lot of times we take for granted the impact that this assembly has in the world around us.
9 years ago, Sharon and I came to pastor at Cornerstone. And when I came, I began to pray about what Yahweh had for us here and what he wanted us to do, the direction and a vision for Cornerstone. He gave me that vision 9 years ago. Okay, it's posted on our website, you can read it, but part of the vision that he gave me is that Cornerstone would be a catalyst to start new congregations. Okay, I have been in dialogue with a pastor who has married up with a Baptist church in Stella, Tennessee. And the Baptist church has decided that what they want to do is become biblical roots. And what they did, if for the last year, he's been in dialogue with me, and they've been watching what we do here. And he says, Pastor, you guys have inspired us so much. He says, would you be our covering as we start this new work? So, I said, let me think about it. I said, okay. So I went to the elders, okay, and the elders got excited. They're thinking, oh my goodness, this vision thing is really working. He's really doing this, right? So we all agreed that this is where we needed to go because this is the vision that we've been given, and or at least part of it. And so we green-lighted it and said, this is a good thing, okay, that we're going to get this started. So we've got the ball rolling. They have a building. Now listen to this. The original congregation down there died out, but they kept the building. So they have a building. Now it's old and it needs repair, so we gave them some things, and they want to actually have their kickoff in about 2 to 3 weeks, their grand opening, if you will. And so we gave them some money for paint and that kind of thing, right, so that they could get started. But and we sent, they actually took our bylaws and are forming their own bylaws according to Cornerstones, and they actually want to structure under Cornerstone. And they also, the pastor said, I want myself and my elders to be accountable to you and your elders. And so there's this relationship that's beginning to form, and it's really wonderful. Which brings me into another thing. If you feel like they have some needs to get started, and if you feel like giving a donation and designated for that particular congregation as they do their startup, please give and designate it for, call it Cornerstone in Stella, Tennessee. And please give, because we're gonna end up helping them out a lot as far as how to structure and so forth. So I'll be working on, you know, all that stuff to help get them started. So what do you think about that? Y'all looking at me like you're not sure what I like, maybe I spoke Hebrew. Yahweh's moving.
To understand the implications of what's happening here. How many of us ever would have thought for a moment that what we did here had impact someplace else? It's amazing to me that not only has the Heavenly Father been watching over us and blessing us, somebody else has been watching us too. Never doubt that people aren't watching you. When we talk about being separated and being acting like priests and making ourselves set apart, that's serious business, and people take note. So know that what you, each one of you, do here has had an impact in Tennessee. That's amazing to me. So never tell me that what we do here is futile. Never tell me that what we do here has no value. For I can tell you the proof is in Tennessee. Isn't that exciting? Amen. I think we ought to give the Heavenly Father a hand for that. This is amazing stuff. And I do want to encourage you, because this is going to be an ongoing relationship, an ongoing opportunity to help build that assembly and put an imprint, that if you do feel led to donate, those monies will go directly to them. They do have some needs, they have some wants, and they have some desires. We're going to help them basically with their needs first and foremost, but maybe you may want to find out what their wants and desires are and help fulfill that. So that's awesome. Anyway, I'm excited to have an impact like that. Yes, sir, quickly. Yeah, just talk to one of the elders, and we have some of those things listed, too. You betcha. Okay, let's have some gentlemen come forward, and let's bless the children. And let's bless them like we really mean it. Let's all stand, and then we're going to hold our hands towards the children, and let's bless them. Go ahead, get underneath the tallit, please. Pack them in there. Wow, how exciting.
May Yahweh protect and defend you. May He always shield you.
strengthen them, Yahweh, and keep them from the stranger's ways.
May Yahweh bless you and grant you long life. Spouses who will care for you. May Yahweh protect and defend you. May Yahweh preserve you from pain. Favor them, Yahweh, with happiness and peace. Oh, hear our Sabbath prayer.
Amen. Let's give the Heavenly Father a hand. Isn't it exciting? Please remain standing as we prepare our hearts to worship.
Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O Yah. And your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Blessing and honor, glory.
You look forward to declaring his praise face to face. This one who has helped us through every struggle, this one who has been with us in every trial, this one who has awakened us every morning and put us to sleep at night, this one that we praise. Amen.
Amen.
Our help is in the name. Yahweh, our help is in the Maker of heaven and earth. Our help is in the name.
is in the maker of heaven and earth. Oh, let Israel say.
Sing that again.
Our help is in your name, the name of Yahweh. From the enemy, Yahweh had not been on our side. We would be caught like a bird in the snare, but oh, Yahweh is there. Our help is in the name of Yahweh. Our help is in the Maker. I'm swept away my water from the enemy. If Yahweh had not been on our side, we would be caught like a bird in a snare. But oh, Yahweh is there. Our help is in the name of Yahweh. Our help is in the Maker of heaven and earth. Our help is in the name of Yahweh. Our help is in the Maker of heaven and earth. Oh, let Israel say, our help is in the name. 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 Our help is in the name.
On the road marked with suffering, those days. be your name. Blessed be the name of Yahweh. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to stay. Now blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. But my heart will choose to say, now blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of Yahweh. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of Yahweh. Blessed be your glory. Blessed be the name of Yahweh. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of Yahweh. Blessed be your glorious name.
Thank you.
Baruch Hu.
Baruch Hu.
As we sing the next song, if you're able to remain standing, would you do so? If you need to sit down, please do so, whatever you need to do at this time. I'm going to sing a couple more songs.
With a strong right hand, sing hallelujah. For Yahweh our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For Yahweh our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with a strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with His faithful love. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah. Sing
around before you break up into little groups and see who's missing. We need to pray for them. We have people on the mend. I know that I thought I saw Kathy here earlier. She's actually able to get around much better than she was. But keep Jen in prayer and also Tim Blair. Keep him in prayer too. He ended up in the hospital Thursday night from some bleeding in his stomach. So keep him in prayer. He's out of the hospital now. He's at home, but keep him in prayer as we go into this. So remember those around you. And here's what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to pray for one another again as we go into this time. You know, if there's a need, if someone in the group has a need, make sure you make that known, where people can begin to pray for those things. So let's go. I'm going to ask the elders to come forward. Let's go ahead and break up into the groups. And if you'd like to be prayed for up here, please come. Turn with me today in your Bibles to John chapter 19. John chapter 19. We're going to be taking a look at verses 25 through 42 today. That's John 19, 25 through 42. Let me read this. It says, standing by the execution stake of Yeshua were his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Yeshua saw his mother and the disciples he loved standing there, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, when Yeshua knew that everything was now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I'm thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was sitting there. So they fixed a sponge full of sour wine on hyssop and held it up to his mouth. When Yeshua had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." Then bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Since it was preparation day, the Jews did not want the bodies to remain on the execution stake on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a special day. They requested that Pilate have the men's legs broken and that their bodies be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. When they came to Yeshua, they did not break his legs, since they saw that he was already dead. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and one's blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows he is telling the truth. For these things happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled, "Not one of his bones will be broken." Also, another scripture says, "They will look at the one they pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was with disciples of Yeshua, but secretly because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might remove Yeshua's body. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and took his body away. Nicodemus, who had previously come to him at night, also came, bringing a mixture of about 75 pounds of myrrh and aloes. Then they took Yeshua's body and wrapped it in a linen cloth with the Aramaic spices, according to the burial custom of the Jews. There was a garden in the place where he was crucified. A new tomb was in the garden. No one had yet been laid in it. They placed Yeshua there because of the Jewish preparation and since the tomb was nearby. Let's pray. Father, as we go into this time, I just ask that you just reveal to us just all that's taking place here and what's going on. Yeshua, I am amazed at just how intricate this really is. And I ask these things in the name of Yeshua. Amen. You know, there's as we've been looking at this idea of relationship, there is some really astounding stuff that's been that this shows coming out of Scripture here. You know, last week we talked about not to murder. We talked about our relationships with each other. We talked about last over a couple of weeks honoring our parents and all of this. And you know what? Really, this is all part of that, but it goes deeper. And I want to take a little deeper look at this whole thing. At this point, somewhere between 12 years old and where Yeshua is hanging on this execution stake at this point, Yeshua's stepfather had died. We don't exactly know when that was, but by what he's going through here, we can tell that he wasn't in the picture at that time. Okay, because, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. So here he's got his mother, okay, and his mother is there watching her son die on this execution stake. Now, you know, when much of us would turn to different things that we would emotionally go through. For instance, mothers, can we get the microphone now? Because I may be asking some questions. Mothers, if you saw your son hanging on this execution, what might be going in your mind? Going through your mind, I mean, at this time.
I can't imagine. I cannot imagine what that would be like. But I know that I would feel a deep sense of loss, and I would my heart would be broken. I would be angry. I would be frustrated. I would probably be a little bit crazy.
Well, I don't have sons. I have daughters. But when I think about Mary, and everything she went through right from the conception through the whole process, that I have to think that she was coached and counseled through the Spirit in some way, so that maybe this wasn't so much a surprise that this happened. Although knowing it's coming and actually having it happen, you know, you still aren't totally prepared for things like that. But I still think that Mary was comforted somewhere before it happened so that it wasn't so devastating.
Anyone else? Guys, if you were hanging on this execution stake, what would be going through your mind?
For me, it'd be just unmitigated anger, absolute anger, especially since innocence was involved. And where's the fairness in all this?
Well, a lot of pain, for sure. I don't know how any of us could actually begin to think of that, because he couldn't even breathe for half of it. He had to lift lift his legs up just to gasp for a breath of air. Mm-hmm. I couldn't imagine. And then sweating blood the night before is an actual, like it's like a symptom that people get with extreme anxiety, and they'll actually start to sweat blood. So I couldn't imagine what he went through.
Well, since our life isn't really our own and we're bought and paid for, we just have to yield to what Father has for us in the future. And, you know, it is a precarious future. And I feel that many of us might have to give up our lives in obedience to what purpose we have to finish out this finish out the end of times. And I think you might, you know, just mentally, I think you mentally have to prepare for the uncertainties of life. There's no guarantees. We just have to be grateful for every day we get and give honor and praise to him.
The reason that I bring this up, okay, is because what Yeshua is doing here is carrying out his responsibilities as a firstborn son. Now, I got to tell you something. When you think about that idea, how focused was he on the things that he needed to do? Because you know what? You all said stuff that really was true. And I was thinking about myself. If I was hanging there, and I am a firstborn son, if I was hanging there, would I be thinking about carrying out the firstborn responsibilities? But he was. And you know what? It's the individual that is the firstborn has an incredible responsibility. You know, much of the time we think about the firstborn's inheritance, the double portion, right? Being about getting extra money, right? but that he got extra money because it was his responsibility to take care of the family. He would actually be the one that gave the inheritance to the rest of the family. Right? And so let's turn to Genesis, actually, chapter 17. I want to look at verses 17 through 22. Genesis chapter 17. And verses 17 through 22. And it says, Abraham... Wait a minute here. Abraham fell face down. Then he laughed and he said to himself, can a child be born to a 100-year-old man? Can Sarah, a 90-year-old woman, give birth? So Abraham said to Yahweh, if only Ishmael was acceptable to you. But Yahweh said, no, your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will name him Isaac. I will confirm my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for the future offspring. Here's the firstborn, okay? Now, do you realize that the firstborn, if you will, to Abraham was not Isaac. He had Ishmael by another wife, by Hagar, right? But do you realize that Abraham and Sarah actually concocted a plan that was not according to Yahweh's plan? Now, here they are. They're looking at things like probably most of us would. And they're saying, oh, well, you know what? I know that Yahweh's word is true. I know that he keeps his word. So what we're going to do is we're going to help him. And so I think what you ought to do is you ought to follow the man-made law that says that I can give my handmaiden to you and she can become your wife and you can have a child through her. Paul calls it impulse of the flesh. Right? But Yahweh says no. He says that's not the firstborn. That's not the one that I call the firstborn. Because I'm going to give you a child between you and Sarah, and that's going to be the firstborn that carries on the covenant. Now, I'll bless this other family over here, but they're not going to carry the covenant. They're not going to carry the firstborn responsibility. You know what? It turns out that just because you're firstborn does not necessarily make you qualified to get that firstborn responsibility. Because there were other firstborns within Israel that lost their firstborn rights. Do you realize that? Look at Genesis chapter 25. The other thing, too, I want you to notice, did you realize that Yeshua had four brothers? Do you realize that here he does not give the responsibility of the double portion to any of his brothers? Okay, I'm going to get back to that. I wanted to bring that up just before we read Genesis 25, 17. Genesis 25, 17. Or excuse me, 27 down. It says, when the boys grew up, and it's talking about Esau and Jacob, right? Okay, it says, when the boys grew up, Esau became an expert hunter, an outdoorsman, but Jacob was quiet, a quiet man who stayed at home. Isaac loved Esau because he had a taste for the wild game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking a stew, Esau came in from the field exhausted. He said to Jacob, let me eat some of that red stuff because I am exhausted. That is why he was also named Edom. Jacob replied, first sell me your birthright. Look, said Esau, I'm about to die, so what good is a birthright to me? Then Jacob gave bread and lentil to stew to Esau, who he ate, drank, and got up and went away. So Esau despised his birthright. Now, listen to me. When we look at the scheme of things, who is really the firstborn? Weren't they the ones that were redeemed out of Egypt? It was the firstborn. These firstborns don't belong to the parents. They belong to Yahweh. It isn't the parents' responsibility to tell them to do anything but what Yahweh says to do. So if you've got a firstborn who doesn't care anything about his birthright and about being Yahweh's, then you're not qualified. It's happened in other places in Scripture where the firstborn rights were left. Do you realize that Yeshua's brothers, four brothers, were not believers? In fact, they needled him about stuff. We don't see those four brothers show up until they show up after his resurrection in the upper room in Acts. So somewhere along the line after the resurrection, they got it. Okay? He gave the firstborn responsibility to John for his mother, because John was a believer. And that whole idea of he was talking to the disciple, the one that loved Yeshua, that's what it was about. We talked about it this morning, about, you know, how that in John chapter 14, let's just go there. I'm trying to save my memory here. My memory banks are not working as well this morning for some reason. John 14, okay, starting in 15 and 16. It says, if you love me, listen to be careful. This wording is important. If you love me, you will follow my commands. Did you get that? If you love me, you will follow my commands. That's why John is saying the one who loved Yeshua. And that's why Yeshua is doing this, because he knows that John loves him and is willing to follow his commands. You see the responsibility? Yeshua wants to make sure that his mother is provided for, and that she's taken care of. So he turns to the one that would be responsible spiritually for his mother. While he's on the execution stake suffering, while he's on the execution stake suffocating, he's making the decision still. But you know what? That qualified him. Listen to me. He was not only the firstborn of Mary, but listen to me carefully. He was the firstborn of Yahweh, of the Father. And he would take on the responsibilities of the firstborn of Yahweh's household. He would receive the inheritance. Now, let me clue you in. You do not get an inheritance of your own. Our inheritance comes through the firstborn, Yeshua. Did you get that? He was readying himself to carry on as firstborn and receive that inheritance so that he could take care of each person's inheritance within the family. It's an amazing event that took place. And it's much deeper than most of us were ever taught. How amazing. As I listened to the thoughts that most of us would have if we were in that place, what he does is so much different than what would go through our minds that it's just unbelievable. I don't know that I can even comprehend how that would take place. You know, by all rights, what we think, by all rights, the focus should have been on me. I'm the one that's dying. Right? But instead, his focus is on the responsibility that the Father had given him to carry out, both for his mother and for all of us. Stop for there just a minute. What are your thoughts? Because in Sunday school, we just talked about honoring Mary. We didn't talk about what it really meant. We didn't talk about, you see, we were taught that we each have an inheritance, and that's true, but our inheritance comes through the firstborn. We would not have an inheritance had it not been given to the firstborn. Did you get it? It's hugely important because it deals with our relationship with our master. Doesn't it? Now listen to me. That brings in a whole other point. The whole other point is I can't enter into a covenant. I can't enter into an inheritance unless I've gone through the firstborn son, Yeshua HaMashiach. You think this wasn't important? Where's the microphone? Any thoughts at this point?
I have a thought. You know, you're talking about what would be on our mind if we were being crucified. What I'd be thinking exactly what he was in when he was sweating blood. I'd be thinking about all the wrath of Elohim, that cup that he was going to be taking. That I have no doubt in my mind that he was not stressed over the pain. He wasn't stressed over the execution, wasn't stressed over the shame. He was stressed over the fact that being a perfect being, never having sinned, not even comprehending it, only love and true judgment, and then suddenly knowing that you're going to be, but knowing that you're going to be taking on all the wrath for all the evil that everybody on the planet has ever done. Imagine never even comprehending why somebody would do evil and then taking on the wrath and the judgment for that. In that, with that cup, that's the cup he was talking about. He's like, is it possible? Let it be passed, but let your will be done, because that's a frightening thought. Being a being that only knows love and taking on all that evil.
Anyone else?
Think of first fruits.
Just a minute.
That's just for your benefit. Couple of things, and one's a question. How do the women work in this? There had to have been families that had only a female offspring. Is it still apply? Do you know? Has that ever been talked or taught about it? Do you know?
I'm having trouble hearing what you're saying.
Okay, if you don't have any sons, who gets the firstborn thing? Does the woman carry it, or do you know?
Actually, if we look at some of the writings in the Brit, and I like to do this because it helps clear things up, Paul tells the congregation to take the widows and to take care of the widows, okay, that have served, that don't have the family nucleus, for them to take on widows that are the righteous widows, the ones that have served faithfully, the ones that have done, you know, according to Yahweh, have done well within the body, and tells them, the congregations, to take on that responsibility. to make sure. So I'm sure it was the same way in the community of Israel, is that the widows would have been taken care of by the community itself, because you know, that's what it's showing. So whatever synagogue they belonged to was probably formed some kind of plan to have them taken care of.
Then if you have a younger child that is a male, he becomes, it's the firstborn son in that case.
Well, yeah, it gets passed down. But okay. That's what I'm pointing out, is that we first, you know, really the truth is, if we looked at things just from a fleshly standpoint, he would have probably should have passed it down to one of the four other sons, probably the next in line. But in this case, he didn't, any of them. He passed it on to John.
And then the other thing I was wondering about is you talk about the responsibility that's on him. In John 17, he mentions that that your son glorify you, Father, just as you gave him authority over all mankind, so he would have that firstborn authority, so to speak, so that he might give eternal life to all those who you have given him. Mm-hmm. And you know where it says the Father has to draw somebody unless they come? So the two of them together are really determining, giving you a chance at least to make your choice, right, one way or the other.
Right.
Somehow there's a partnership going on there with the Holy Spirit, I guess, drawing and then the Son
I don't know, it seems to work that way all through Scripture.
It sure does, doesn't it? It's cool. I love it.
There's one over here too, Derek. Okay.
Thank you very much for this. You know, I just keep hearing one word go through my head. This is huge. So I'm going to do a lot of praying and for me meditating on about Yeshua being the firstborn, passing it down to John, you know, to take care of us. I went, oh, why didn't I see that? You know, thank you. I appreciate that very much. And more of how it spreads to the whole body and et cetera. I'm spending a lot of time looking at the birthright and how that passes down. There is a case addressing the issue that was brought up over here. I think it was on the Exodus when they were still on Mount Sinai, and there was a family of women, and there were no sons. So they were afraid that they were going to lose their family's inheritance, and it would just disappear. So they approached Moshe, and it gave him a ruling on it, but I don't remember what the ruling was. But there was a way for it to be preserved there so that they didn't lose their family's inheritance, which to them is important because it's a tribe, and they have the land apportioned to them and everything. And Yahweh gave them that word to look over them.
Yes, they did take on the firstborn inheritance, if there's no men.
I was just thinking the first fruits. You know, Christ is the first fruit. He gave of his first fruits. And then you mentioned the firstborn, the first fruit to the loin or to the Lord. That was just a thought that went through my head.
One of the things I wanted you to see is that there is a spiritual implication of the firstborn. Okay? That's key, because once again, the firstborn belongs to Yahweh. That's what it clearly says. It tells us in the Exodus that the firstborn is to be given to Yahweh. And so there's a spiritual implication that this responsibility given is not only monetarily, but spiritually as well. So he would take on the responsibilities of spiritual lead of that family.
I was thinking about what he said up there about what you'd be thinking of, and yet Yeshua made sure that we have the hope in that, because we have Paul, who was and was crucified. And Paul even made a statement and said, if I could go to Sheol or hell for the people, he would. So he actually, Yeshua transformed him into what our hope is for all of us too. So to look at that and see it, it's amazing, because we have the Torah, we have the whole book. So, and we have all the examples. So, in other words, it boils down to, do you believe in in the Word? Do you believe in Torah? And that's where it's at. Do you believe in what we're truly learning about this, that he's already made a way because he already did it with Paul and Peter and the rest?
Look at Genesis chapter 35 and verse 22. It says, while Israel was living in that region, Reuben went in and slept with his father's concubine, Beulah, and Israel heard about it. And if you look at verse 22, it says that Leah's sons were Reuben, and it says Jacob's firstborn. Okay, now go to Genesis 20 or 49. And let's take a look at verses 3 and 4. It says, Reuben, you are my firstborn, my strength, and the first fruits of my virility, excelling in prominence, excelling in power, turbulent as water, you will no longer excel because you got into your father's bed and you defiled it. He got into my bed. So he lost the firstborn rights because of what he did. So character and morality counts in the firstborn. Once again, it takes it back to the spiritual ties, because Yahweh doesn't want his firstborn falling into immorality, because that firstborn can't live one way and bring the family in another way. Any other questions?
I was wondering something about the firstborns. It says the firstborn males who open the womb are set apart to Yahuwah. So, but what if somebody is a firstborn male, but they didn't open the womb? Because, like, what if they have a sister that's older, or then vice versa? What if
male that opens the womb?
Yeah. So okay. But, and then what?
So the sister wouldn't. It would be the same thing, okay. unless of course. I mean, there would be an inheritance given to them. If they only had daughters, uh-huh. Okay, so that the family wouldn't lose their inheritance. But it's the firstborn male that comes to the womb is the firstborn.
Okay, because like for instance, I'm my father's firstborn son, but not my mother's. So it's
the responsibility would actually revert go to you as the firstborn son.
Yeah, because I've always been wondering about that.
Anyone else? Here's what I want you to know, okay? Here's what I want you to walk away with. Number one is that we cannot have an inheritance unless we go through Yahweh's firstborn. Period. Okay? That takes away the argument that I don't necessarily have to go through Yeshua to be saved. You see what I mean? And if we would understand the way that Yahweh set this whole thing up, we would realize that. Now, at some point, Judah's eyes are going to be opened. And when Judah's eyes are open to their Messiah, then they will actually come into an inheritance through Messiah. Do you see that? And by the way, Scripture says that Judah's eyes are going to be open. So we'll take care of that one right now too. Okay? The next thing is that our character and morality counts as far as firstborn. Once you've been, let me ask you this. Once you've been given to Yahweh, do you have the right to remove? That's why Paul said, you know why Paul said that I've been bought with a price, I'm no longer my own? It's because he was given to Yahweh. He doesn't have
a deciding factor. That's what he's saying. I'm a bondslave. I don't even have it. Nobody asked me my opinion. I'm just going to do what he wants me to do. You know, when we make the decision to follow him, and we make that decision that we're his, the idea that we could tell him what we want to do and what we don't want to do is out the window. Right? Because he bought us with a price. Our wills are not our own any longer. It's a good thing that he's merciful. Because I know back in slavery days, even in America, if you didn't follow your master's orders, you were beaten and eventually killed. Right? Man, I'm thinking, how many times have I gone to him and say, well, I don't know about this one. Okay, I don't really like this part. Right? I don't want to do that one. That's too hard. We can't do that. You know, I'm thinking, how long ago did I not understand this and when I was still trying to pick and choose what I wanted to do? I'm going to tell you something. I'll tell you a little secret. My running from him totally ended about 9 years ago when I took this congregation. I did not want to come. I turned this place down 4 times. They kept calling me back. And I kept telling them that we had this conversation, remember? Listen, it got so bad that I worked for community enforcement downtown Salem. It got so bad that my boss down there told me to prepare somebody to replace me. And I said, are you firing me? He says, no. He said, I wish I could have four more of you, but you don't belong here. He says, you should be pastoring. Can you say that here? But that's what he told me. He told me that several times. And you know what? I knew I was supposed to be pastoring. But because I got ticked off at the congregation or at the church back then, I didn't want to do it anymore. And you know what? He was patient. He dogged me, but he was patient. He chased me. But he was patient with me. Now, there is some repentance that had to take place, right? And that's when you realize, you know, most of the scars on my body, and I have a couple, you can ask my wife, most of the scars on my body were time periods in my life where I was running from him. And he allowed something to happen that gave me a limp. Go figure. So I don't want you to do it that way. Well, you know, I think it's best this way. Well, okay. I was in the military because I was running from Yahweh. And he chased me for 16 years there. And then finally, I guess, he just allowed that me to go off the side of that hill. Gave me a limp. So, a reminder. So, you know, when you look at this whole thing, he's serious about what he wants to do. And he's serious about who you are. He's serious about his firstborn. Because they're the ones that are going to make sure that everybody else has their inheritance. And so, you know what? When Yeshua was going through this life, Yeshua was totally careful about what he did. Because he was the one without spot or wrinkle. He was the one that that was going to carry this responsibility for us. And you know what? At the moment he said, it is done. It is finished. We talked about that this morning. We talked about in John chapter 7, him saying, I will finish the work that's been given me to do. And in John 19, we find that it is finished. The works that I had to do are complete. Right here. Now here's the deal. You brought up first fruits. First fruits is a whole other issue because he was also our first fruits that was waved before Yahweh, waved before the Father, so that we would be accepted. Look at the stuff that he did to make sure that we were accepted. And if we'd have just known that we could see it all in those Jewish holidays, go figure. Right? Yahweh's holidays, by the way. Every step that we read this morning, every step that we read, it actually goes back and points to Yeshua as being the Passover lamb. For instance, if you go back to John 19, starting in, since it was preparation day, the Jews did not want the bodies to remain on the cross on the Sabbath. Okay, the reason for that is they weren't even supposed to remain on the tree overnight. They were supposed to be taken down, okay? Number two, this was a high holy day, which would have been the Passover that evening, so they didn't want him on there either, okay? So there was two reasons that he had to do that. But if you look at it, it says they requested Pilate have the men's legs broken and that their bodies be taken away. You know where that comes from? It comes from the Passover lamb, that not a bone will be broken on the Passover lamb. There's your picture, right? That fulfills Scripture. And so every one of these fact points are points that point to him and who he is. I'm going to stop right here. If you want the rest of the notes, you can actually, I send out emails each week that has the place where you can get my notes. What you need to do if you're not getting my weekly reports, then go to our website, www.cornerstonebaptist.net, and on that you can sign up for our newsletter and you'll get the notes each week before service. I used to get them out by Thursday, and that way you have time to look at them if you want. But you can go there and get the notes and get all the references that I have about this sermon, because I never get through all of it. I just never get through all of it. There's just so much to talk about there. So you can get all that through there. So are there any questions or comments or whatever at this point?
John 17, verse 19. See, this is his prayer here. He says, for them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. So basically what you said, he knew what he was doing, and he was thinking about all the future believers who were going to come down forever because of the power of what he did, being who he was.
Right.
I just think it's amazing about the breaking of the legs. The only reason that they didn't break his legs was because he was already dead. And everybody knows that type of torture was designed to keep you alive as long as possible. So the fact that he was already dead was just amazing in and of itself.
Well, and that's another point that I was going to bring up in the notes that I didn't get to it, is that his life was not taken from him.
That's right.
It clearly says that he gave up the Spirit and that he made that choice. And so when you look at the whole thing, they didn't kill him. He gave his life up willingly, or he laid his life down willingly for us.
In John it reads, but when one of the soldiers pierced his side with the spear, and at once blood and water came out, and I have been taught that he died of a broken heart, and that's why the blood and the water was separate.
Well, there's actually, I didn't bring it up because there's some tradition involved. And some of the people that traditionally thought of the blood and water as representing the water that came out of the rock when it was stricken. And when I looked at that, I don't know that entirely, I mean, it could be, but I don't know that entirely fits what took place there. So, and if you'll notice, it also says that by that, by them sticking him in the side and the water and blood, they recognized that he was dead because of that, okay? So apparently there's a collection of fluid that fills the heart, so when they poke it through him, and heart and lungs, when they poke it through and he gets blood and water, they recognized him as being dead at that point, and they didn't pursue it any farther. That's what Scripture says. Now, having correlated it back and forth, we can look at this whole thing, because they also, it says that they gave him sour wine. Some versions say vinegar, but actually the word that's used there in the Greek is actually sour wine or vinegar. You could choose either one. But apparently slaves used to use it when they were working out in the fields, because sour wine apparently quenches the thirst. Okay, but there is a picture, if you will, because if you remember, what did they, the wine represents what? Blood. And what did they wipe on the lintel and the doorpost? And what did they wipe it with? Okay, they dipped the into the blood with the hyssop. And that's exactly what they did with him, is they gave him this sour wine off of hyssop. And one other picture of him being the Passover lamb.
I have a question. Is it ever accurate to say that we individually are a first fruits, a form of first fruits? In the context is, I once heard someone pray over another person, because that person was the first in their family to be a believer, and they said, you are a form of first fruits, or you are the first fruit of your family to believe in Yeshua.
Actually,
to be
the firstborn of your family.
Firstborn.
Because the first fruit was actually a picture of Yeshua that we go through for an inheritance.
Yes. Yeah, so
and so in my mind, first fruits, it wouldn't okay. be first fruits, because it was through him that we're accepted.
Yeah, he is the first fruits. If we might be the firstborn, but he is the first fruits.
Right. Anyone else? Oh, huh?
I know, I can never shut up. he's the firstborn of us as a whole of a family, but the firstborn is the firstborn of the small family, the individual,
right.
The little kingdoms,
right.
Because it's the kingdoms of the heavens, not kingdom necessarily. It can be plural too, you know, as a collective. So that's our each own little firstborn of that family, but He's the firstborn and first fruit of all of the brethren and the sisters.
You know, the only point I wanted to make out of it is those of you that are firstborn have a responsibility before Yahweh. And it also dictates how you should be behaving, if you will, to stay qualified as a firstborn.
Firstborn spiritually or physically?
Physically. Well, both, actually. But the firstborn, especially physically, okay, have a responsibility, okay? We all have a responsibility, but firstborn have a responsibility to lead their families into the spiritual walk that the Bible shows that we're walking.
I have a question to that then. If you have an older brother, you know, firstborn, but does not know of God, does not know of those ways, but then later on, you're reborn, you know of that, do you now become the one responsible to hand down those traits, being the firstborn spiritual?
Well, it was never handed down to, that we know of, it was never handed to the brothers of Yeshua. As far as we know, the way it makes it sound, okay, remember, it doesn't say this word for word, but what it makes it sound was at least John was the one that took on the responsibility, because it says that he took her into his home from that moment. So it looks like John continued to be her covering.
Yeah, I think the physical don't matter at that point. Once it's the first, we're talking about firstborn, first fruits. The firstborn is the first fruits of the womb, but it's the firstborn's responsibility to bring the first fruits, Yeshua, to the family. That we see that first with Cain and Abel. See, Cain was the firstborn, but his fruits were not acceptable. So, and that's why he kills Abel, because the inheritance actually then was transferred to Abel, because his offering, he bought the lamb, he brought Yeshua to the family. So then he had the inheritance, and that's why he killed him, to get the inheritance back.
So, anyone else?
This is kind of, I don't know, this is really kind of an ambiguous question, but what happens in a situation where one is the firstborn, but the household, the father, will not accept nor listen to the spiritual guidance when they are, you know, like off, when it comes to stealing, murdering, terrible things, you know, like with my father, and I've tried to over and over again, but not forcibly, but lovingly, you know, guide him and show him these ways, and he's been many times where he's gotten close to where he's starting to repent and seeing it, but then he goes back. You know, like what kind of, I really don't know how to put that question, but what's kind of a good way to what someone would do, having that responsibility but not able to exercise it fully?
You know, as I look at Yeshua and the way his brothers, if you will, chided him, Yeshua knew his responsibility and carried out his responsibility regardless of what anybody else said. But he did not give, I don't see anywhere where he gave them a hard time. He seemed to be very patient with them. Even when they were telling him, you need to go into town. If you're looking to be a public figure, you need to be where the people are. You know, and it says that he went ahead and stayed back for a bit and then kind of went incognito to the festival after that, okay? So he was real patient, and it sounds like that he let them have their say and then did what he was led to do anyway, you know, from that point. He knew what his responsibilities were, and he followed them, you know, because obviously it was accepted by the Father, because he became the actual, you know, Passover lamb and the firstborn. But I think that the way we deal with things, and I've talked about this before, is hugely important, especially when it comes to unbelievers in our household. You know, to be honest with you, I've seen over the years, I used to, when I first got saved, man, I was the worst. I'm sure glad that I didn't bump into me. Okay. You know what I mean? Because I would never be saved today if I had bumped into me. Okay. But I found over the years that being patient with people is probably the best policy. I'm not saying break Yahweh's laws to be patient. But what I am saying is that sometimes the way we put things, sometimes the way we, our body language, sometimes our zealousness or how we raise our voice or anything can turn somebody off. And I think that we have to be more aware of how we present ourselves to people than what we are sometimes. Because, you know, to be honest with you, I'm going to tell you, I get zealous from time to time, you know. And I think that, especially when we're new to the faith, zealousness can be an issue. I mean, I want you to be zealous. I want you to love those. And I want you to embrace those things with all of your heart. But I also want you to be aware of how we may be presenting ourselves to those in our families as well. You know, Sharon and I are really fortunate, and we have believing kids that don't believe in what we're doing. But they accept us. They love us. We get together as family. They know we don't do Easter and Christmas and Halloween, but they don't force that on us. They don't cause, you know, say, oh, well, I can't believe you're doing this. They know. That's because we have not crammed it down their throats. When they ask questions, I talk to them. You know, our first little discussion came at camping one time. Now, everybody in the family knows that Sharon loves shrimp. Okay? Our first camping trip, having devoted ourselves to biblical roots, came along with my son wanting to bless his mother. And so he bought all this shrimp and brought it to the campfire. Now, my first thought was, oh, no. But that's when we decided that it was time to have a talk. Okay? And so we sat down and talked. And you know what? My son was not offended at all. Just because we explained to him what the Bible says and what we've decided to do. And we didn't force it on them. You know? They ask questions, we talk. And that's been the way it's been coming about. Why they don't want to do it, I have no idea. But at this point. But you know what? I know that it's getting through their heads because here's my granddaughter, and my granddaughter goes to school, and they ask her, does anybody speak another language? And she raises her hand. And they said, well, what language? She said, Hebrew. And then, and you know what? She goes in and she brings the festivals into them and into the school and begins to talk about all those things. This is my granddaughter. Okay? My grandson doesn't even know that there was a different way. You know what I mean? If I don't sit down and pray so that he can eat, he's in a little tit, you know, he's in a tizzy, right? Papa, pray, you know. Now they're not doing these things at home, but they know when they're with Papa and Grandma, these are the things that they need to do, and they do. So I don't know what's happening with my kids, our kids. But, you know, with the grandkids, there's an impact. Because they can see that we love mom and dad, regardless of where they are.
Well, to kind of follow actually what you were saying and what you said earlier about Paul and the widows, I think what's Jesus doing here by passing his mother on off to John, besides making sure she's taken care of, is establishing a new parameter for families, and that taking it more out of the fleshly and putting it into the more spiritual.
I think it was always intended to be spiritual.
Right. Well, he told his disciples that they were to no longer acknowledge that they had an earthly father, because from then on it was to be a heavenly one. So that by passing it on to her, he's kind of setting the foundation for that for future. The relationship was going to be more important from a spiritual aspect than from the natural. Mm-hmm. And by starting it this way, and then Paul just ran with it when it was necessary. Right. Yeah. He says, if you give up brothers and sisters, well then follow me and I will give you, will have more of the same, more of the family. But it's a different, because the family is going to be the body of Christ. But it had to start somewhere.
Right. Okay. Want to do some announcements?
I have props. This is my prop. What'd you say about presenting yourself to the family, first impressions? What do you think? We, tomorrow, starting 9 o'clock a.m., we are all going to come and volunteer and clean our assembly. What do you think? I could just see the excitement exuding from your bodies. You're maintaining yourself to keep from leaping into the IOAs doing handsprings with anticipation. I'm not quite sure. I haven't found the pull rope yet. This is to remind us that we have an opportunity to come in and to volunteer a small amount of time from 9 o'clock to 12 a.m. tomorrow. Just spend a little bit of time coming down, find a little place that you can clean, and make a difference in our building. Don's going to be here. Say hi, Don. Hi, Don. They're right there. And I would like to invite all of you to come down. If we had enough people, we could get this place tip-top shape in just a small amount of time. Don't you think? Now, there's a rumor that there's going to be coffee and donuts for some of those who are just hesitating. Maybe that'll put you over the top. Coffee and donuts. Coffee and celery. Okay, anyway. So this is just a reminder. Coffee and hummus. Yeah, there you go. I'd be right there. Okay, announcement time. Please consider coming down. Just spend a little bit of your day to come down. 15, 25, 30, 2 hours. Come down and spend a little time cleaning the assemblies. I tell you what, you can truly make a difference. Amen? All right. Okay. We still need Oneg setup help. If you would like to come down and help to set up the Oneg, many hands make the work very short. We are still looking for volunteers. Azure, I said it right, didn't I? Azure. Okay, the cutoff time is coming up for phone orders and things of that nature. In fact, there's Don. Don, why don't you come up here and clarify Azure and how all that works. Thank you, Don. It's kind of exciting. I believe our daughter participated. She's up in Washington. They drop it off at a church or someplace. They actually go clear to Washington. And she called us. She says she was amazed at the quality of the product and how it was packaged and delivered. So it's kind of a neat thing for this family that has taken it upon themselves to deliver quality food for us. Okay. Also, we need help in the nursery. We talked about that last week. That could even include guys. Okay. Franklin Graham's going to be here on June 28th in Salem. We'll have more information as to what the time is going to be. This is for the Decision for America tour and prayer. Pardon? Noon-ish, noon o'clock. At noon o'clock. Okay, good. Shavuot is coming up very quickly because we're going to be ending our counting of the Omer. Speaking of which, all you mathematicians, what day is it for the counting of the Omer? 43? Did somebody say 43? Who said 43? Darren said 43. Wrong, it's 42 anyway. He counted one toe too many times. Okay. So also, just as an encouragement, my wife kind of gave me this idea. Read from Psalms 113 and 118 to kind of get in the swing of things and make a connection to Shavuot. It's a wonderful time. You know, there's never a bad time to read the scriptures, is there? No, there's never a bad time. Okay. Oneg. I want to make a comment about Oneg. We've had some people ask about the Oneg and what kind of food, and we try to, if we can, remember to put, you know, what the ingredients are, what you call the food, and that type of thing. I've seen some bowls. I'm not quite sure what you would title them, but they were really quite good. One of the key areas is that we always want to make sure and use biblically clean ingredients in what we eat. We all want to have confidence that what we're eating does, in fact, meets the standards the Heavenly Father has given us. And on the back, in fact, there are some of these in the back table, tells you an idea of some of the things we'd like you to participate in. How many of you would like to pick up a spoon that has been picked up by somebody who hasn't washed their hands all day? Does that sound exciting? I'm sure all those little germies are clean and wonderful to be shared with. So we invite you, in case that's not your idea, to use hand sanitizer. We have that up in the front to wash your hands with. Always remember to allow guests and seniors to be first in line. Is that a good idea? I think it's a grand idea. Okay. Parents, please supervise your children as they move through the buffet line. Please be sure that you have a little bit of a control. We've had some instances where we've had children going hither, thither, and yon, and not only putting food in their plate, but spreading food throughout the assembly, okay? And here's one. If you're ever towards the last of the line, what is your hope? That there's food left. Now, I have noticed sometimes, I don't think people do this on purpose, but they go through the line and they seem to pile more joy than they need on top of their plate as they exit the line. And so the people come up behind them, about the 40th or 50th person, and they're actually counting the number of beans they have in their plate. Be sure and realize there's somebody behind you when you pick up your serving, so we can all have an opportunity to share in the bounty that the Heavenly Father's got us by all your voluntary bringing of the food. So just remember, and when you think about the Oneg and some of our responsibilities, think about your neighbor, okay? And then speaking along the same line, we do have, can I still use the term senior citizens? We have some very wise people that come here in assembly, and sometimes they are not as mobile as they once were. Please be aware of some of the children that come barging through and running up and down the hallways. Make sure they are aware of that. I really don't want them to collide into some of our wise individuals. The wisdom that we have in this assembly is awesome. Does that sound like a good idea too? Okay, the 10th annual for Israel conference is coming up. We'll have some of these in the back. How many went last year? It was at the Red Lions Inn in Portland. Well, David, how would you grade that meeting? Did you enjoy that? Thank you. What was so awesome to me is to be with people that believe the way I did. Yeah. To see that Cornerstone is not a little island unto itself. There's other believers like us, and to be associated and get a chance to say hi to people that believe the same way we do. We don't have to explain ourselves. Yeah. Huh? It was exciting. This year it's going to be one in the Messiah, and we're going to have Bill Cloud and Dr. Kenny Russell. These are in the back. Be sure and get an opportunity to sign up. This is all going to happen July 8th through the 10th, okay? Be sure and include that. Okay, be sure and give Sharon any updates for the directory. We don't want to have false information about who you are and what you're about. Be sure and get that to them. And then on, let's see, June 11th, we're going to have that National Shabbat. Is that correct? And the armory will be at the armory. It'll be open. The doors will be open at 5:30, and they will have an Oneg there. You're going to have to be supplying the food for the Oneg, so be aware of the National Shabbat celebration. It's going to be once a month, and this month it's going to be June 11th at the armory. Okay, Sukkot. We're beginning to wrap up the finalization of Sukkot. So be aware and just keep, be cognizant that we're going to have some ongoing announcements for that. We're going to have sign-up sheets and all the different things that we're going to be doing. Last year was rather unique and exciting. Let's see if we can duplicate that again. Understand the importance of Sukkot. Understand what the Heavenly Father is trying to plan for that. And realize it's actually the last play, if you will, before the Messiah comes back in his timeline. It's an amazing thing that you always wonder, is this the one? Is this the one? Or is it next one? Sukkot is an awesome time to get together. Okay, let's see. If there's anything that I've forgotten. Boy, I feel silly with this orange thing on. But you're never going to forget it, are you? You're thinking clean the whole time, aren't you? Thinking cleaning? Okay, you're thinking the guy's weird. All right. Let's see. Is there anything else we've got coming on? Have I gotten anything anybody can think of? Thursday night, thank you. We still have prayer at 6 o'clock here at the assembly. Awesome. Thank you so much for that. Okay, do we have time for a few? Anybody got a testimony or two? Awesome.
This is weird. I've had testimony that I've been resisting telling for about 5 weeks now. Every Saturday I come here and it just pounds my head and I've been refusing to talk about it. All the other day weeks, I'm fine. So I'm giving in. The reason I've been resisting this is talking about a very dark period of my life. When I was about 22, I tried to take my life. I tried to use a overly modified handgun. And when I say overly modified, I had to keep this thing unloaded at all times because I accidentally tripped the trigger many times just picking it up. I get to a point in my life where my career feels horrible. I'm about to go into a divorce. And I feel totally isolated from my family, so I feel completely alone. I decided that this is the end. So I load up the gun, I put it to my head, and the trigger would not move. And the first thought in my mind is, how stupid am I? I'm trying to kill myself, and I leave the safety on. I take a look at the gun, and the safety is not on, it's actually off. I put it to my head again. I try to pull the trigger, and it would not move. I took the gun, I unloaded it, and I dry fired several times. Click, 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 super easy. One of them actually was by accident. I loaded the gun back up again, put it once more to my head, and the trigger would not move. At that point, I said, yes, Lord, I understand. I put the gun away. I never saw that gun again until the day I sold it. I got very clearly that suicide is not allowed, which came in very handy in other periods, dark periods of my life later on down the road. Since that time, so many great things have happened in my life. So many great things I would have missed out. So much influence, and now I can see that I've had on other people's lives that I never would have had before. We all can get into periods where we think we're alone. We think that our reason for being here is over, or that we even actually feel like we're just useless and taking up space. That is never true. It's only the devil trying to convince us otherwise. If anyone ever feels this way, feels like you're going through this dark path, first thing you gotta do is you need to reach out to your loved ones, to your friends, to your families, to whoever you feel you can trust. Because once you start talking about it, once you start sharing with them, you realize it's not nearly as bad as you think it is. It's not nearly as dark as it is. Anyway, thank you.
Michael, I'm glad the trigger didn't work either, because you've been missed. You're part of the fabric of this assembly. You're a very important part. And that's a thing we need to realize, how important each and every one of us. Nobody's supposed to be missing. Our fabric of this assembly becomes stronger because the more that participates, it makes us stronger. It's easy to break one string, two strings, or three strings, and each one of us represents that string. You combine us as a whole through the power of prayer in the individuals, and with the help of the Heavenly Father and the breathing of His Spirit, we cannot be broken. We are stronger than that. So thank you so much. Anybody else? That was wonderful. Going once, going three times. Rick.
Okay, second time I'm going to preach, so. How many would want to be blessed? Okay, how about if we stand up? And Yahweh spoke to Moshe, tell Aaron and his sons how you are to bless Israelites. Say to them, may Yahweh bless you and protect you. May Yahweh make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May Yahweh look with favor on you and give you shalom. In this way, they will pronounce my name over the Israelites, and I will bless them. You may be seated, and they'll start passing out the bread and the juice.